Have you ever stopped and asked yourself, what makes games so special? Why did playing as Geralt in The Witcher, Joel and Ellie in The Last of Us, and Commander Shepard in Mass Effect feel so much better than watching a movie or reading a book? It's because games give us the one thing that all of those couldn't: consequence. And consequence, well, that's about the most important thing about being human. Besides family, friends, your pet Labrador Cooper, that one guy at the supermarket who was super chill. Don't ruin this for me. Because here's the thing. Games are unique because of the choice and agency they give us, letting us succeed or fail alike. But I don't think that choice actually matters all that much. Rather, it's the propensity of a game to radically realize you instead. Let me explain. Back in 2014, Ken Levine, the guy who originally made Bioshock, gave a talk at the Game Developers Conference about what he called narrative Legos. To him, games are meant to be systematic in design, and what separated what he was trying to make from the millennia of entertainment that came before him was he wanted to make media that radically realized you. What he meant was games that spoke back to the player, worlds where whatever you did, and no matter how you did it, the environments and its peoples would react accordingly. Or in other words, games that had real consequences for your actions. And I think Ken got it right where so many others get it wrong. It's not about giving players tons of choice in dialogue or gameplay, it's about making us think about those choices. A choice in a game doesn't matter because it changes something in-game, it matters because it changes how we think outside of it. Who cares if a game has tons of random extraneous moments where you get to decide the fate of a small town or entire city? That's not the core of what makes those moments special. Like in Fallout New Vegas, when you can decide to convince Alice to discombobulate her own mother. Because why not?
Oh, you think I won't do it? You think I'm not right in wanting back my life? I'll show you. What have I done? Mother.
The scene is only funny and interesting because of how the game reacts to your decision, not the decision itself. It's the consequences of the actions within the context of the world that makes it special. The choice on its own would just be a meaningless yes or no button. It's not about making games with more choices to pick. It's about making games that radically realize the ones we do. You know, recently I sat down and played through the entirety of Pentiment. It's a murder mystery game set in the 16th century that includes almost no gameplay, but rather just lots of well-written dialogue and intrigue. It's the type of game I usually get bored of quickly, but something about it hooked me. The characters were lovable, the writing was witty, and the world was beautiful and well-realized. But what stuck out to me most the more I played was just how intimate the story felt. And I don't mean that in a lovable sense. I mean that in the sense that everything I was doing in the game felt important. The choices matter. Early on in the first act of the game, someone is murdered and it's your job to figure out who it was. But instead of giving you ample time to investigate everything, there's a day and night system where you can only investigate a handful of leads before you have to make your decision. This means time is of the essence and every single piece of evidence you track down results in less time looking into another. The choice of even what to do in game comes down to choice and consequence. If I decide to get someone to help me dig up a grave to find a murder weapon, that means I won't have time to go into town and question a kid I saw running away from the murder scene. And this type of game design is so, so much more powerful than what we're traditionally used to. In most games, this sequence would simply play out with you investigating every lead until the entire story makes itself clear to you and the ending sequence of the game plays out with you figuring out who the killer was. But in Pentiment, you're thrust into a dire and stressful situation where you have to decide what the best course of action is. And by design, by the time you have to make your big decision, you won't know if you're making the right choice. And that's what makes the choice in Pentiment so great. Choosing who to kill will result in the murder of a potentially innocent person, the ultimate consequence for your hasty actions. The reason that's such a powerful tool is because that's how it actually is in real life, too. In real life, we don't get to finish every quest and get a perfect, happy fairy tale ending. We have to make do with the time we have and make tough decisions. decisions that can haunt us for the rest of our lives. Pentiment shows just how much potential games have to give us a journey that actually means something to us, that makes us think and feel emotions of pride and guilt alike. And it only gets better too, because you see in Acts 2 and 3 of Pentiment, you get to come back to the town years and decades later, and you get to see exactly what effect your decisions had on the town. How has the murder trial and the people killed now affected the direction of this small town and the future of its people? Pentiment does a great job of telling those more personal character stories and showing the saga of each of them. But here's the most amazing part. The game feels awesome the first time because it seems like all of your decisions made the story entirely different. But they didn't. No matter what you do, no matter what decisions you make, if you go back and replay this game over and over, you slowly realize that the major story points always play out the same. You can never kill the real murderer in Act 1, no matter what path you take, and the town always devolves into chaos with one specific peasant rising up in Act 2. So isn't it all just meaningless then? Was all that choice in the first and second acts for nothing, since the ending is always the exact same in Act 3? No, because the choices never mattered. The consequences did. Maybe the story will always play out the same way, with the same killers and same main plot points, but the consequences of your actions through each of those decisions are very different. Killing or accusing specific characters will result in entire different moments with their family and loved ones, and it's those moments that are more powerful than just a simple choice. Seeing a family mourn for a man we wrongly pushed to death is powerful because we did it. It's our fault, and only games or real life can teach us that. That our actions have consequences, and that we can truly have an effect on the world around us. You know, one of the biggest lessons I've learned in my entire life through this journey on YouTube, streaming, building businesses, and working hard for the people I love, is that your actions do matter. The life you forge for yourself is from your actions and your actions alone. All the good and all the bad, that's because of you. Sure, the story may play out the same way. The main characters in the world will always be the same or have the same ending. We are dealt our own hand after all. But it's the consequences of our own choices, no matter how small or minuscule they may be, that truly mean something, because they are the things that will last with us forever. That's why games are so special, because they are the one medium where we can have real consequences for our actions and a world that radically realizes us, just like our own. It's not about the fact that we get to decide who lived and who died. It's about the fact that we got to see the effect we had on those that meant something to us when we did. A perfect example of this is Cyberpunk 2077. I've already talked enough about how amazing this game is and how amazing it always was, but one thing I think Cyberpunk really made me realize, besides how we should always be forming our own opinions, is that choice in video games isn't as impactful as I thought it was. I used to always say games like Fallout New Vegas, Mass Effect, and Dragon Age were the pinnacle of what games should be because they gave us endless choices that affect the story. But as I've gotten older, I've realized that actually isn't what makes games so special. Cyberpunk didn't have a lot of choices that drastically changed the game. There was a couple for sure, especially the endings, but for the most part, the sequence of events in the game always plays out the same. Trust me, I've done enough playthroughs to know at this point. The moments in the game still mattered though because the game made you feel like the illusion of choice actually meant something. It felt like you had a real effect on the world, and thus, the world had a real effect on you. Like seeing Jackie's ofrenda and the speeches the characters give if you send him back to his mother. Watching Judy cry uncontrollably while holding her dead friend in a bathtub. Seeing Pan Am make a toast to Jackie near the fire. Or riding through the waves with Cary Uradine as he plays one of the best songs in the whole game. These moments meant something regardless of whether or not there were 20 other random options we could have chosen. Because on the first playthrough, and each one since, those moments were still mine. Ones that meant something specific to my V and his journey. When you watch a movie or read a book, the best ones teach you the most important lessons in life. But as anyone who's been alive for long enough can tell you, humans don't learn from listening or watching. We learn from experience. And in Cyberpunk, the experience of meeting someone who is filled with sadness, or someone who would die for you in an instant, is one that truly teaches you those lessons. At the end of Cyberpunk, you can make the decision to become the greatest in all of Night City, or forego that dream of yours to instead focus on the most important things in life, the people you love. And only by getting to the end of Cyberpunk and having that decision to make do you realize how important of a decision that really is. It was never about having lots of choices to make. Cyberpunk plays out the same way no matter what you do, but that one choice it does give you, and all those little ones that didn't matter throughout the whole story, do matter more than all the other bullshit in Fallout or Mass Effect. Because that decision at the end of Cyberpunk to choose family over money isn't a choice, it's a realization. A radical one, and it makes you think about your own life. Games don't need choice. It's fun choosing whether to divert water to the business city or small starving band of deserters in Outer Worlds, but their reactions to your decisions either way is the best part. And reactions like that can happen regardless of if there were big choices beforehand, like Cyberpunk has shown us. I think what I'm really getting at here is that choice does matter in games, but not like people think. It's not about adding a bunch of dialogue, speech checks, or decisions like where to divert power in a city. It's about making every moment in the game a choice itself. Because games that radically realize each and everything you do, whether by giving you characters that comment on your actions or story beats that truly mean something, these games can be special. And the one game that shows this more than any other is a game with barely any story at all. Prey Moon Crash, the greatest DLC of all time to the greatest immersive simulation game of all time, shows you how you make real consequences. Because you see, Moon Crash's entire gameplay loop revolves around a never-ending simulation where you must escape from a top-secret moon-based research facility with all five members of your crew in one run. The genius of the game, though, is how it intertwines the mechanics and elements of time together. One character class may have access to hacking, which you need to get through a door with, and a future character on that run of the simulation can then get into the room and repair since they are an engineer class. And on each new run, things can happen like power outages, new locked doors, or crazy enemies in places you least expect. All while the simulation gets harder over time until it fully corrupts and ends. I could talk about how great this game is though forever. After all, you guys have seen, I love talking about Moon Crash and Cyberpunk in what seems like all of my videos, because I love both so much. But here I want to focus on why Moon Crash feels great and is an amazing game. It's because Moon Crash doesn't hold the player's hand. Just like in Pentiment, where the narrative has true consequences that show your actions matter, Moon Crash does the same, but with gameplay. Each and every step you make in each simulation run can drastically affect the outcome. If you store a gun in a hidden locker early in the simulation, when things are easy, you may find your character on a future run having a hard time being able to pick up the gun and save themselves in a tough situation. Planning is super important as you need to have an idea of each location you will go to and what you want to accomplish, and if you don't execute and plan properly, you will die and lose. And even more than that, Moon Crash is one of the first games that feels like it does in fact radically realize you, just like Ken Levine argued years ago. Because each weapon and every tool you can use in Prey has multiple uses. You can use the glue gun or glue bombs to freeze enemies in place and run and fight, or you can use the glue to reach high up spots you otherwise wouldn't have access to. You can use the stun gun to disable flying drones attacking you, or you can use it to blast the Typhon gates and turn them off so you can get to closed off locations. It's these ingenious mechanics that players have discovered on their own that make the gameplay so powerful. Each and every action has a meaningful consequence, even in gameplay. Prey Moon Crash is so powerful too because not only does it give the player limitless choice and freedom, like so many games before, but it also radically realizes everything the player does and responds accordingly. All in all, choice in video games is a weird thing. It's a key ingredient that separates the medium from any other, and gives players actual agency to make decisions for themselves. But I don't think these choices are actually what we are after as players. Rather, we just want to be heard. We want NPCs to react to whatever we are doing to them, whether that's goofy things or in serious moments. We want gameplay where the worlds are systematic in design and react to each and everything we do. Because to me at least, that's what makes a game so special. It doesn't matter that we have choice, it matters that it feels like we do. Regardless if the game always results in the same ending or the same things always happen, just make the world feel like it was because of us, not the developers making the game. Because that sense of pride, accomplishment, or horror in feeling the results of our own actions is what makes us human. and it's what makes games so much better than books, movies, and television. For decades now, games have improved their graphics, mechanics, storytelling, and presentation. But for the coming decades, I hope the new ones can focus and turn to something even more meaningful and the thing that will make this medium truly memorable. Games that radically realize us. And as always, thanks for watching.